All right, what's up, everybody? Today's day 186. Making Songbringer, but I'm making a ghost sword item today, which is it's gonna be awesome. Can hardly wait to create this thing. So it's gonna be a lot like just a projectile. It's a projectile type of weapon that you can basically get this piece of technology, which allows you to shoot ghost swords from your regular sword swing. Yo, what's up, Excellence? Howdy, man. So I'm gonna get right into starting to drawing it. Right now. How you doing today, Excellence? Whoa, crunch time. 2 months of hardware to do in 2 days? Dang. Low. What's up, Azurus? Azurus, I'm not sure if you were watching the other day, but I released some new C++ code. Master level procrastinator. Atta boy. I don't know if you've seen this yet, Azenris. Yo, what's up, Felix? So today I'm making an item called the Ghost Sword, and this thing is just Alex Pita. What's up? This Ghost Sword gives you a projectile attack. Yeah, totally. See open. What's up, man? Welcome to the stream. Yes, it's because of back issues. Neck issues, actually. Spine issues, you know. About 10 years ago, I had a real big spine issue because I'd coded for so long that I was like this too much. And I got my neck actually reversed how it's supposed to be curved. So I did a lot of traction to get it solved. And I found that one of the best ways I can keep my neck and back good is to just stand while coding. And I totally do. I also find it hard to sit for a long time myself, too, because it's like when I sit down for a long time, my butt gets sore and I find my back gets all like bent and stuff like that, and I get tired. Okay, so let's start drawing this. Where did I put it? Ah, there it is. I need a background. Yeah, nice. Yeah, try it out, man. It's a really simple setup. I don't have a standing desk or anything. I'm just inside a closet. I've got, like, my computer sits here on top of this shelf, top shelf, and then, like, my keyboard and everything is down there on some boxes. So you don't have to actually have a standing desk to be able to stand and work. That's one way to do it. Totally, right? It works, man. There's all, like, I always see these advertisements for, like, sanding desks. The Vari sanding desk and all that. But you don't need that. Gremlin's got my keyboard, man. Yes. Yeah, Alex Pita, good point. Yeah, you mentioned that before. So let me... Let's take that out right now. That's where you used to say courage. I'll need to put that into the game. Yeah, they are totally right. That's what I'm saying. All those advertisements for expensive standing desks. I have not seen them to be necessary myself. Oh, yes, yeah. No, I do the same thing, too. One trick I found for standing for more than an hour or so is I actually, if I put my legs together, and it's weird to kind of do that, but standing with your knees touching and your feet kind of touching actually works. I used to code all day long, like 8 hours a day, and that's kind of my default stance. And another thing that's really important is you've got to keep moving, too. Like, it's actually bad for you to stand in one place for a long, long time because the blood in your body needs to move. So you want to move around. You want to go get a glass of water. You want to, like, just do stuff to stay active and keep your body moving. So, but yeah, that's one stance I've noticed. If I put my feet together, my knees together, and stand as straight as I can, that's like that really, really helps to stay. I don't know why, but it kind of props me up better. A padded mat. Oh yeah, really? I don't know. I haven't ever tried that. I noticed that wearing shoes helps. Some good comfortable shoes. That's also really, really important. Okay, there we go. Now we got all the text removed from this, so I can go and actually apply all that in code and use localized strings. So if this is in Italian, it's going to be, what's the Italian word for map? Spanish is mappa. You got it, Alex Pita. I know you mentioned that before, so I was meaning to do that. It's the same thing. Romantic languages. I love how similar they are. Okay, let's go. Let's draw this Go sword. Where did it go? Hey, thanks for following. Yeah, so similar. French, Spanish, Italian. Yeah, same origin. Portuguese. It's probably a lot more, right? Time is tempo, really? All right, cool. We're ready to draw this sword. And also, I'm gonna get it to be a new layer-based slice. Actually, I'm going to duplicate this a bunch of time because I know I'm already going to have a bunch of combos for this item, which can transform it. So this is the fire ghost sword. Actually, no. I'm not going to do this yet because I want to draw the ghost sword first. So I can hold on, I can at least hold off on naming all these right for now. I want to turn off viewing slices there. Sword is Spada? Spada Fantasma! Sweet. Okay, let's give this sort of a bluish glow. Really? No way. I guess Marzipower rubbed off on me. In the one day he was here, I was able to pick up a little bit of Italian accent. He didn't even really talk with an Italian accent, really. He actually spoke very American-sounding English. So I'm just kind of getting an initial glowing effect going on here. Right? Yeah. Hey, welcome back to the stream, Takio. Tasio. Always want to learn how to program video games. Thinking about taking courses? Seems hard. Tips for beginner. I use a programming language called C++. Tips for beginner. Here's what you want to do. I know it does seem kind of overwhelming at first, because yes, programming languages. What's up, Light of Thief? Daniele says, ciao. Nice. Right on. Ciao, Daniele. Yeah, Tasio. So here, at first when you start out learning anything that's a big, long, this is, learning to make games is a long process. It's a very complicated process. It's like learning to fly a plane, you know what I mean? Or learning to drive a car is actually a pretty good example. At first when you're driving a car, like driving a clutch car, like a manual transmission car, there's a lot to learn at first, right? But after you learn it, it becomes second nature to the point where it's so easy to drive, right? The same thing with programming games. There's a lot to learn, but if you take it in small doses, that's probably the best way to learn. Take it in small doses, absorb a little bit each day. My biggest piece of advice I can give to you is to do what you love. So focus on that. When you're learning to make games, focus on the parts that you love. If there's a part of game development that you hate or you're not interested in at that point, don't learn it. Don't be learning that kind of stuff. Do the stuff you're excited about, and that will make it a very enjoyable process, because if you don't love making games, you're not going to finish it. You're not actually going to learn. So what you want to do is do the things you love, and that will make it really, really, really easy and fun, and you'll forget all about how hard it seemed, and it will smoothly flow. You know, that's how you get in the flow. You do things you're excited about. So, and then my other advice about getting started in game development is to start with finding a game engine. So you want to go play around with game engines. go try out Unity, try out Unreal, try out all the game engines you can until you find one that you like. And then, after you've found a game engine that you like, then start doing some tutorials. And then, finally, after you've done that, then you can start learning programming languages. Programming is not the first thing I would recommend learning with making games. There's so many different game softwares out there like Unity and Unreal where you don't have to really learn to code at first. You want to learn the more the process of building components together and creating a game. So I think that's more important to learn than it is to learn programming, especially at first. I hope that helps, man. Yeah, exactly. Just like Platformer Labs just said. And welcome, Platformer Labs and Low Music. What's up, Yumi? Hello. Yes, I use a MacBook Pro Retina. Double pixeling in Photoshop? What do you mean? What do you mean double pixeling in Photoshop? I'm looking at my screen right now and there's no, I'm not sure what you mean by that. C-Open, you see a lot of indies using 2D engines. Is it possible for an indie to dev a 3D game? Yes, of course it is. You know C++, but haven't done any games. Is it possible to do stuff like Wipeout Style Racer? Yes, I don't even know what that game is, but yes, of course it's possible to do it. Making games, you can do anything, man, anything at all. And C++ is an amazing language to know already. I would stick with that. I wouldn't even try and ever learn anything else. And doing 3D games, all you need is a 3D game engine. There's a great one called Cocos 2DX, which is now 3D. It has all these 3D tools and 3D stuff, and it's in C++, and it's cross-platform, which is incredibly important. And this is the game engine I use. It's called Cocos 2DX. I use it for its 2D, but like I said, it now has 3D features as well. I don't... What is Wipeout? Wow, it looks really good. Is this, it's supposed to be a newer game, huh? Super awesome graphics. Makes me think of Star Fox. Nice. Okay, so I'm gonna go and start adding in a little bit of more transparency around the edges. Actually, I'm gonna use a brush for this. Yumi, I don't know. I've never ever seen that problem. Like if I zoom in, I'm still just looking at pixels. I'm not sure what you're saying there. Yo, what's up, Taco? No, he was telling me I'm the one that doesn't know what Wipeout was. I should be banned from my own stream. All right. See, I'm gonna use a brush. I'm gonna turn my eraser into a brush for a second. And set it to about 5% opacity. Yes, I'm banned. I've banned myself. Wipeout. I did start playing Dark Souls, though. So, I'm finally starting to catch up with some games. Dark Souls, I see why so many people like Dark Souls. It's really great how unconventional some of the things that it does to you is, like the freaking huge boss you have to fight right at the very beginning of the game, where you're like, it's almost impossible to beat him, and the only way to really do it is to get past him. Yeah, I gotta, I'm excited to have finally be playing it. Yeah, it is very hard. Have I heard of Limit Theory? No, I haven't. Bloodborne's even better? Cool. You know, I mean, I like these games. They're cool, but the one thing is I don't really like 3D games that much. I really prefer my 2D games, but that said, you know, Dark Souls is an amazing 3D game, and I'm glad to be playing it. Yeah, I heard Bloodborne was really awesome. Wow, this looks beautiful. Yeah. Wow, he created his own engine from scratch. That's a lot of work. All right, now I want the sword underneath this ghost sword to desaturate. What's up, Brunsbear? Yeah, there we go. Totally desaturated. Now I can. I think I'm gonna take the eraser, put it back in pencil mode, but keep it at like really low opacity so I can just do some really tiny touches to this. In fact, I'm gonna put this opacity to like 20. Do I miss the dynamic capability? You know what? What's great is I'm actually using Rapid Game as this thing that's pre-compiled most of my code, so I don't have to compile a lot. So when you notice me, like I'll even change a header, and 20 it only has to compile 22 source files. If I only compile change a C++ file, it almost runs instantly. So I really am not worried so much about having to recompile too much because it's so quick. I've used dynamic languages in games before, and I've always found them to be problematic. You write something in some kind of scripting language or whatever, like JavaScript or Lua or something like that, and there's always bugs, man. Oh, the bugs are crazy. And then you have all these problems with like, okay, what was the syntax in JavaScript versus the syntax in C++? I actually prefer sticking with C++, and it is possible to actually dynamically change your game. Your game's code if you use static variables. So like if you enter in a static variable, static int something something, you can change that on the fly. So you can, if you run in debug mode, you can actually go and change this variable. So I don't use that technique actually that much, but it's possible to do that. So good question though. Very good, very cool insight there. Brunsbear, I'm making a new item. This is called the Ghost Sword. You're gonna have this item, and possessing it will give you this projectile weapon style attack. What's up, Deez Deser Deserowny? Do I prefer 2D games for graphics or play style? Yeah, mostly because of play style. But also because of graphics. I mean, the graphics are what gives me a nostalgia. That's a really good question. I love this question. The graphics in 2D games are what gives me sort of a nostalgic feeling. I like that. But more importantly, it's the 2D play style that I love. Because the thing I don't like about 3D games is you're like you're always using one trigger to move and then another trigger to move your character where he's looking. I hate that. I hate having to look around in a game. So, like, for example, if you play a MOBA, it's really nice that you don't have to, you don't, it always, the camera always stays at one angle. I like that. I like those kind of 3D games because it's just less confusing and I find it to be spatially more solid. I don't know. I guess I just love the play style more. Oh, yeah. I was thinking it would work more like the magic sword you have in Zelda 1 when you have full health. So I'm going to try it like that at first. But that might also be an interesting thing to try, where it would be an item you could use, and using it would deplete your health. Interesting idea, Alex Pita. That's worth playing around with. Yeah, of course, man. Why isn't there a C++++? There is. It's called C++11, and now there's C++14. So, you know, that's... The whole point is that it's C++ is that is just an increment. You know, there's an increment operator, so they're playing off that. Oh, yeah, C-Open just said it. So, yeah, now I've got 20% opacity. Oh, well, this explains it. I wasn't actually on that layer. There. This is what I wanted to see, a little bit more transparency in some of these edges of these pixels. And now that I'm in a single pixel mode, I can be more precise. Okay. That's good. I'm gonna merge these layers. There's the ghost sword. Yeah, I know. Lambda's awesome. Probably one of my favorite things. Lambda, auto, keyword, and null pointer are my three favorite things about C++11. Yeah, so Xbox Taco, the increment operator, it goes like this. If you understand programming languages, int c equals 0. That initializes the variable c to 0. And it's an integer type, which is just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, just like that. C++ increments it. So now C basically equals 1. See what I mean? That's what the increment operator does. It increments a variable by 1. There's also C minus minus, which would put it back to 0, right? So C++ starts at 0, C++ goes to 1, C minus minus would bring it back to 0. So hope that there's your programming lesson for the day. Yeah, I have heard of Transistor, the guys that made Bastion. Totally, it looks great. I'm guessing it's probably a 3D engine, myself. Yeah. What's up, Exardes? Yeah, this is already a pretty. The game's already working, man. Let me show you. It's all programmatically created, and it's procedurally generated game. So I don't design levels at all. I do design certain areas though, and I work on actually. Oh man, how did it lose my save game already? Well, anyways. What world code should I use? Any first person to shout out six letters, I'll start with that. What's up, Anatolian? Yes, I'm the guy who painted the peacock. It turned out great. It's on the wall now. My girl loved it. What's up, Squirrel Power? You had a similar question. What if you did plus plus C? It just increments it before. Yeah, C Open's got it right here. It increments it before it uses it. What programs do I recommend? I recommend you start with finding a game engine, like I was just saying, and that will kind of guide you in what programs you will use. The engine I use is called Cocos 2DX, and therefore it's kind of a cool thing to use Xcode or Visual Studio if I were on Windows. I use Photoshop for making my art. I use Audition for editing my waveforms. I use Ableton Live for making music. I use Texture Packer for packing the sprite sheets. Hope that helps. Popo. Slow Excellence says letter. Just the word letter? Jetta. Oh, that's only five. Wizard, that's a cool one. Lasers. Let's do lasers. I like that one. Yeah, speedrunning is going to be cool for sure. All right, we'll do lasers. Just because it's a sweet word. And I've already done wizard before. So we'll just make sure that lasers, this world works. Yeah, see, open. This is all my own font, all my own artwork. Oh, it auto-corrected to Jetta? What was it you're trying to say? Popo's butt in German, really? There's no button to do a random seed yet, but that's a good idea. Whoa! I haven't played this game in a minute since I added all these new enemies, but I forgot that I think I maxed out every single room with as many of these burrowing enemies as I could. Yeah, burrowing enemy! Die! This is great. Oh man. I'm really thinking of having this happen a lot in the game where there's just a room full of so many enemies. And maybe you have some kind of like refilling health item or something like that, or some cool shield which protects you. Great. These guys are really surprising. And I'm almost dead though. I gotta save and quit. So yeah, this is kind of what the game's like. It's like Zelda 1 and it's procedurally generated. So I gotta... What's up with this? Why didn't this... I think I might have to fix the game because I changed the way things work with save games recently, with all this whole new Valtree stuff, so I might need to fix the game before I can even play it today. Yo, what's up? Jedsa, oh. What's up, Shoko Coco? Hello. Are you guys lagging? Dang. It's like a surprise party that went wrong. Yes, horde mode, right, exactly, yeah. There'll be some kind of horde rooms, like specific rooms where there's just a horde of enemies, because I love those kind of rooms, they're so fun to play. Yeah, Dekarki, I did do some benchmarking a while ago with rooms like that, just full of hundreds of enemies, and it took me a while to get the game to where it could actually even handle that many enemies. So, yeah, totally, C++ does really help with that. Anatolian, yeah, the game's coming out in about 5 months now, probably January, March, something like that, around there. So, okay, this game might be broken, I'm not sure, because I don't think it loaded my save data that last time, and it saved the game twice here, so... Oh, I see what's going on. It's not prefixing... Yeah, it's not prefixing it with the right word, so, let me see if I could fix it really quick. Oh, Butter Broham, it's coming out on Windows, Mac, and Linux on Steam. Exactly, it's already been greenlit. So if you guys want to check it out, it's already. If you want it on your wish list or whatever, Songbringer.com has a link to it. So yeah, here's the link for Steam. So if you want a wish list or whatever, here's that link. Yep. So yeah, it's coming out first on Steam, and then it's also coming out on iOS for sure, because this is all thanks to the Kickstarter. Kickstarter went well, everything was great, and one of the stretch goals that got hit was iOS. So iOS for sure. Nice, Funky Squid. Thank you, man. Cheers. Oh, it's so great. Every pre-order helps me make this game better, and every one of your guys' pre-orders will just help me push back the date that I can release it a little bit, because right now, as far as funds go, I'm going to run out of funds in December, so I kind of like need to haul ass and make this game as fast as I possibly can right now, because there's so many more ideas I want to put in. So basically, every one of your pre-orders is going to help me make this game better before it initially releases, so I can put in more story elements, more items, implement more of the ideas you guys have shouted out over the time. So once again, thank you. I really appreciate it. Yeah. High five, Funky Squid. Psh. Yes. Okay, so I see what's going on with this save game. A little bit of what's going on. It should have saved with the zero in front of it. Make save. Huh. Oh. I see what's going on. Okay, we need a variable called K here. Ah. Like, we make a save game key off of that key, and then we use that whenever we, for the rest of this method. So there. That should fix that huge bug with the save games. All right, man, good night, Brunsbear. Okay, so this new save. Mega Seed Lasers. So I'm just hacking this save game back into place so that I don't lose what I just started there. So that's what it should have been like. Should prefix all this stuff, and it forgot to bind my keys as well, but that's okay. So that should work so I can run it again, and now I'll at least start again at the same place it should. I try not to, that's a great question, C-Open. I try not to have a schedule. I hate schedules. I hate milestones. But yet, I did have to recently go and kind of create some milestones and stuff. Oh man, it didn't work. Whoops. Okay, let me see what's going on. Yep, you can tell I haven't tested the game in a second. I just changed the way that all of the save files and everything are saved in this game. That's why I'm having this bug. So there's something that's missing in here that's causing it to not even recognize. Oh. No, that's not it. Okay, I'm gonna start the game again and do another save. And that should help me see what's missing. Yeah. I'm trying to do earlier streams because I know a lot of you guys are in Europe. So, yeah, I've done this before where I'll try and do like streams like a couple hours earlier, a couple times a week. I'm thinking I might even start doing them more regularly earlier in the day because it seems like almost all of you guys are in Europe sometimes. I know there's, you know, some of y'all are in Canada and the US and other places like that too, but. Save games will work again if you install Windows 10 and delete System 32. What's up, the Grim Gary? Oh, this is so funny with all these like burrowing enemies in here. Yeah, so I'm gonna get it to save the game again, and I can see what's different between that save game and my existing save game. Figure out why it's not saving. Let's at least get out of this room here. No way! Oh man, this is crazy. Missing Evil Awakening, where did I move that to? Right, it's kind of cool how they hid, right? Alright, so it's crashing because it can't find this file, but oh, here we go, at least it's saved. Evil Awakening, what happened to you? Scenes. Oh, I moved it to scenes. Okay. Oh, I think I know what's wrong. I recently changed all of the profiles to be text-based, and I think Evil Awakening must have had its sprite sheet. So, sprite sheets, zero, scenes.plist. No, it's not scenes. What's it called? Maybe it's backgrounds. Might be backgrounds. Nope, it's not backgrounds either. Yeah, cool. I love the rock crab too. And what's cool is these new enemies, like the burrowing guy and the rock crab, I have the behavior for them done. So that means I can go draw a new enemy or whatever and with the same kind of behavior and do lots of cool variations. Love music. So if you walk around the world without the sword, everything is peaceful. Very good question. I've been thinking about that, right? Like, what should it be? But I think that you should have enemies because I like the fact that in Zelda 1, you can choose not to get the sword and go. You can beat the entire game without the sword. So I think that it's not that. Yeah, it's not. I think there should still be enemies in the game even if you don't get the sword, but. What's weird is that challenge, the plot is all based around the fact that you get this sword and it awakens the evil army, so I don't know. I'm really, really thinking about that though. Am I using files to store variables to reference later in the code? Basically, yeah. That's what these text files are. All right, I'm trying to find where the heck I stored the. Oh, I think it's might be scene zero. Or scene one. It's not scene zero. Scene one. There it is. Scene one.plist needs to be inside this Evil Awakening thing right here. There. Okay, that should fix that bug. And now that we've got a save game, that's proper, you should be able to run again, and it should at least have a menu. Yeah, cool. It's saved this slot still. All right, that's good. Let's just change this save. Why does it have the jib stash? Lasers! Okay, this should work now. How are nodes and sprites being added to the scene? Just like they would be regularly. You're talking about, yeah, I mean, it's just nodes and sprites are all added to this this one layer I have called area layer, and so all of it goes into there. So basically a sprite is created in my game with a render component. So I use this, it's a entity component system, and it's online, it's free, it's on GitHub. I wrote it for this game, but I released it for free on GitHub. It's called EntityFoo, and I use this entity called a render component, and a render component creates a sprite. And see, I pass in the area layer when I create the sprite, so it gives it that parent right there. And when the render component is just, it just creates the sprite and adds it to that parent. Very, very simple. Here's where it gets the sprite frame it needs to use. Here's where it initializes the sprite frame, or the sprite based on the frame. And here's where it sets up the sprite and adds it to the parent. So it's just very simple code, same as you would in Cocos 2DX. All right, Alex. Good night, Alessandro. Sleep well, my friend. Why am I using explicit new and not shared pointer? I haven't, because it's shorter, basically. It's shorter, and I probably should use shared pointer. I'm not in the habit of it, so I should probably get in the habit of it, even though it is longer. You know what? In fact, I should write that down as like kind of an idea, right, for something I should add or do. Yeah, do that. Oh, unique pointer? Well, I trust Azenris. He's a C++ god. Let's make that unique pointer. Oh, Speedy Flip, thanks, man. Welcome back. Nice. Cool. So, Azenris, what's the one sentence version of the difference between unique pointer and shared pointer? Enlighten us. Enlighten us, mere mortals. Okay, cool. Yay. We started the game again. We have the sword again. This is great. In fact, yeah, I'm just going to leave the game like this for now. I'll leave it in this room and everything. Oh, one thing I want to check is to make sure it doesn't crash when it moves up. Yeah. Cool, so that was the bug with this. Looks like we fixed two bugs there, nice. So I gotta get back to making this whole ghost sword. That's the goal for today, is the ghost sword. Pointer sister? Is that a real thing? Tell me it's a real thing. Oh, it's not. Good joke, man. All right, cool. All right, go sword. So I should have, this should be a layer. In fact, okay, I'm gonna make a few copies of this because I want to do a couple go swords. There's the fire go sword, the ice go sword, the electricity go sword, and the regular go sword. Maybe even the plasma go sword. I'm just gonna keep it three. to start with. Three elements. I know the Pointer Sisters are real. Unique pointer is when it's only owned by one object. I guess that would work for my entity system, yeah. Shared objects when multiple objects. Okay. Okay, cool. Thanks. Thanks, Yopin. Interesting. Ooh. We've started a controversial topic. What's up, Lunar Melt? Yeah, I'm going to keep it with just three elements to start with. These are three elements and the original item. So there's lightning, ice, and fire, basically. Or electricity, whatever you want to call that. All right, so I'm going to move these around. Here's the electricity one. Here's the fire one. Ice one. Let's play with these hues. Huh. What's the purple orb? I don't know yet. This was the ice orb, the blue one. I think the purple one was some kind of, Oh no, this is the default orb. So this is your regular teleport orb, the purple one. And then you can combine it with the fire in a bottle to get the fire one, or combine it with ice to get the ice one, or combine it with the electricity / lightning to get this sort of plasma-y orb. Okay. I don't know. What is GameMaker language? Is that like C++ or what? But if you just want to start getting started with straight up C++, I would personally learn C first myself. Is that a fabulous mustache off to the right? Yes, it is a fabulous mustache. It goes on Jib. It's called the Jib Stash. I'll show you. I'll give the player that. But let me give this link to the Platformer Labs. Platformer Labs, anything. Or C to learn code the hard way. This is what I recommend doing if you're going to learn C++. Ah, okay. Yeah, personally, I would learn C and then learn C++. Here, I'll give the player the Jib stash so you can see what Jib looks like with the mustache. This is all in celebration of the Kickstarter succeeding. I put a mustache on Jib as requested on the live stream. So that's why he has that mustache. It's hard to see him with his mustache with all these enemies, but. Whoa. I got pushed out of the world. Dude, I didn't even know that was a bug until just now. So you can get pushed out of a cave into the abyss if an enemy hits you. I already have another bug that's related to that. You should never be able to get hit off of a screen by an enemy. Yeah, it sounds like it would be. Yeah, totally. You found out about the Jib Stash. Have you seen also another really cool item already? Is the fire teleport. Oh, that's not the word. What is it? I know. It gets bigger every day, right? It's kind of overwhelming, but you know, take it one step at a time. I got to do the most important things first, which are like more items, more enemies, making the overworld cooler. Oh, it's just called Fire Orb. Yeah, these teleports are pretty cool. So you can like get over gaps with these. This is what you're gonna use. Like, I'm gonna hide some levels behind a gap or like across the gap. Like, maybe you have to jump over, like, I don't know, either a chasm or a river or something like that. So yeah, there'll be an ice teleport as well. There'll be a lightning teleport. So there's three kind of teleports. And then there's the original teleport, which is sort of like a super just blinking one where it's like, it doesn't do any graphics. It's by the Pointer Sisters. Oh, thanks, C-Open. Yeah, when I was doing that, I shared the tutorial that I used to make it by. So it's on one of my videos somewhere. Yeah, it's all right. It's almost lightsaber-esque. I didn't want it to be too lightsaber-esque because it's more of a vibrating sword. And also, I don't want it to get any kind of copyright issues with Disney. So, okay, so Fire Sword, we got it. It's going to be about this color. This hue is 16. Let's colorize this. Yeah, but more saturated. Yeah, here we go. This is looking very, very fun. Flaming ghost sword. Yeah. So in essence, I think you should kind of specify what you want to learn. If you want to learn GML, then I would focus more on that. And if you want to learn C++, then focus on that. You know what I mean? They're two different things. So, yeah, well, you know, do what you want, but that would be my recommendation. Okay, so this ice one, we want to make it really cold blue, more brighter. So this is 200, brightness 100. Oh, good night, Light of Thief. See you, man. Wait. Oh, colorize. Here we go. Colorize 200 there. What's up, Momir? Howdy, 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 howdy. All right, now this ice sword is a bit too much like, the existing sword already. So let's make it more sort of purplish. Or no, maybe this should be the ghost sword actually, this purple one. Yeah. This should be the ghost sword. And this should be the ghost sword ice. Now the electricity one, I'm thinking like yellowish. Or maybe, yeah, maybe just white. But I kind of wanted to give it a sort of an eerie glowing thing. Some color, a little bit of color. Do a sort of yellowish one for the electric ghost sword. That's pretty good. Okay, I like these. To start with, you know, I can always change this later. I just need to get something started, an item graphic for these. These are kind of big. But anyways, let's put them in and see if they're too big. Oh, I'm so happy that my graphics tablet works again. It's so great. This is so much faster and better than using a mouse. Nice one. Got a smoldering iron, right? Did I fix it myself? Kind of. I took it apart, and basically I messed with this cable right here. I like bent it a lot. I was trying to get it. I had super glued this thing before to get it to kind of work the before, and then by messing with it and then putting it back together, it works again. I have no idea how, but I am so glad that it does. So that's freaking awesome. Score one for rebooting. What's up, Game Evo? I don't know, man. I don't even know what all those are. But it worked. Right. True, right? Oh, I fixed it. I have no idea what I did. I didn't know that was an acronym. Maybe it wasn't, and it is now. All right, let's turn off this background. Export this. No, not render video. I don't need to render this as a video. Putting this in Sheets HUD, because it's its own sheet. Oh, I think I just, oh no. Exactly, it does. It works better than mostly. Vivo, you were just asking this the other day, man. I thought we gave you some really good thoughts on that. Are you just trying to dig up some conversation here? I mean, that's fine. HUD. I think I exported some frames. Yeah, all these O1s and all that. These are all blank things that Photoshop thought I needed. Don't need that, Photoshop. So I'm going to save this again and then choose all user slices to make sure that I get that in that flow there. Oh yeah, I've seen this one. This is great. Oh, if you guys want to check this out, I found a funny one this morning on XKCD. Uh, Looking forward to seeing your new place. What's the address? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm taking the 495, but I have a GPS, so I really just need the street address. Okay, then south on I-8. Okay, but I have a GPS, so if you just want to skip to the street address, I can... Thanks, I'm glad to know Highland Road comes a mile after the big intersection, but I keep saying, I have a GPS. Can you tell me the street address? Technically, that's just more information on how to get to your place, not the address itself. If you could... I appreciate that you want to help, but I'm ignoring you, and I just want waiting for the... Listen, I just remembered I need to mail you a letter. What's your address? Mm-hmm. Okay, great. See you in an hour. I guess I didn't have to read all this out loud, but this one's funny. All right. Okay, so we've got this item. Let's hook it up to the components now, or the actual, let's create an item for this. So I'm gonna base it here on the sort of like this plasma orb type thing. We need an item constant for it. We got fire blink, fire orb, lightning orb, plasma orb. Okay, ghost sword. Ghost sword, fire. Ghost sword, ice. And ghost sword, lightning. Let's get that compiling. Oh, yeah, I don't have one yet, I don't think. Game Bevo, you keep asking us what we think if you can do it, and we know nothing about you. Why don't you tell us if you think you can do it? Do you think you can create the next Facebook? Yeah, I don't have a lightning orb just yet. I should draw that right now. All right, got him, ghost sword. It's equipable. No, I'm not thinking it's equipable just yet. I'm going to try it out being passive at first. And it's not purchasable. Yeah, see open totally. Yeah, I started this on day one. I literally started... live streaming this game from the very first day. So yes, you see me coding the engine on the very first day. Yeah, but this guy keeps coming back and asking the same question. I don't know. I have a feeling this is not a troll. This is a guy who's seriously just asking that. Game Bevo, look, do you believe you can create it? Why are you asking us if we believe you can create it? What does it matter what we think? Do you think Mark Zuckerberg actually wondered if he could create Facebook? He just did it. If you want to do it, just do it. No item key for item 24. What did I do wrong? Oh, I need item keys for these other ones. That was an assertion check there. So, okay, I need ghost sword, fire. ice, and lightning. You're scared that it won't be famous. Why? Why are you scared? If this is really what you want to do, what are you scared of? Shia, yeah. We are being serious, Game Vivo. We are actually trying to help you. You're asking for our help and we're giving it to you. Okay, so now I'm gonna try and give the player these items. Ghost Sword, Ghost Sword Fire, Ghost Sword Ice, and let's see what they look like in the inventory. Yes, this is a very good point Valveware has right here. If it's good, if people need it, if people want it, it will be popular. Okay, cool. I was wondering if it would fit inside here, and it extends above, but who cares? It fits well enough. So they're not equipable at this point. Let's give them some text next. Yeah, exactly. Dractius picks up a good point. It has to be different enough. They did succeed. MySpace was a killer, awesome social network that was rad. Everybody was using it. And then Facebook was just better. You can't say MySpace failed in a sense. They kicked ass. They made at least millions, if not billions of dollars. How is that a failure? Just because they're not around now, but who cares? They had a good run. Strings. Strings. This is another thing I need to convert into my new Val Tree thing. Ghost Sword. Oops. HUD. Ghost Sword. Something like that. You're using your courage, or some kind of technology based on your amount of courage. Yeah, totally. Good point. Yeah, that's another great example. Oh man. Oh yeah. Yeah, you're welcome, man. I mean, I see what you're saying here. You kind of want to learn it all, right? Digest it all, get all the information. I was gonna say there are a bunch of time lapse ones too. So not there's you have a, that's not what you're looking for. I know you want to like actually look at the episodes or whatever. So, but if you are interested, there's the time lapse videos as well, which are like a really compressed version without any of the talking. Yes, I love your advice here, fat guy, but it doesn't seem like he's listening. So I'm just hooking up these strings so that it at least has some data when you see it inside your inventory. I mean, I'm sure I'm probably going to refine all these later. I'll probably go through and have some moment where I'm like, oh, I should change this text because it's just not that great yet. Yeah, totally. Nice. You finished your first game last week? Nice. Right on, man. It's one of your grades. Really cool. Sweet, man. Do you have any screenshots or anything you want to share? That's pretty rad. Good for you. Valveware, you finished your first game. Oh, it's awesome, man. So awesome. So cool. I remember that moment myself. My personal moment of making my first game. Go Sword. Whoops, I forgot to put the right new line. Cool, man. I think they're, yeah. Pipes. Man, I gotta convert this to using the new format because now that I'm going back to this property list, it's so annoying to have to edit text with the property list in Xcode. So much better to just have all of this in a text file. Grats, for sures. Okay, cool. So now we can start actually making this item do stuff. What I want it to do is just launch a projectile if you're at maximum courage. Okay, so this is in the system where it uses items. I'm gonna turn off or move out my graphics tablet and switch back to mouse mode so I can code a little faster here. Hey, what's up, Nano? Cool, man. Happy homework doing. Okay, so it's this thing called like use sword, use item sword. So I'm going to use kind of a method like this where oh yeah, actually I'm going to put it right here into the use item sort because I want this to work where yo, what's up, Tabby? Yeah, totally, man. Start a game prototype. Do it. Yeah. Okay, here's where it's trying to start a melee attack. Here's where it's successfully doing a melee attack. So, we're going to go like this. Doc, whoa, what's up, Doc? Yo, Doc's back from vacation. What's up, man? Dude, it's going really good. So great. Look at, there's so much new stuff in the game. I hardly know where to start. But one of them is this new burrowing enemy. And check this out. There's a screen full of this burrowing enemy. It's crazy cool. Nice, you finished the mock-up for your game? Sweet. What? Okay, this is your assassin one? The delivery girl? So this is the burrowing enemy. There's just like a ton of them on the screen. That's why it's kind of slowing down a little bit. But these guys are great. They're called the Zurubs. There's several new kind of enemies too. There's a hopping enemy. There's an enemy that shoots stuff at you. There's been so much new stuff done. Oh, there's a totally new overworld that has multiple different paths. I'll show you some screenshots. Oh, sweet. Cool. Hey, also, and this is Valveware's very first game. Whoa, nice. Cool, right on. So you basically just took the board, right? And then kind of made it your own video game. That's rad. Way to go, dude. Come on, Dropbox, you can do it. Load it. I know, speedrunners are going to break it so bad. So that's why it's so great that I'm releasing on Steam first. So, oh yeah, the hermit crab enemy. He's cool too. I forgot. Yeah. All these graphics are from yours truly. Yes, there will be that many. I have planned for at least as many enemies as The Legend of Zelda had. They had about 30, I think. Or so enemies, and I'm up to about 15 enemies now, so I need a lot more. And then there's going to be a boss too for every level, so there's 9 bosses, and the bosses take a lot more time. Man, I don't know what's up, but Dropbox is not loading for me right now. Oh, there it goes. Yeah, nice, man. Does this have the toilet that you were working on the other day? Nice. That's great. Yeah, this is some great progress. It's good. This is how I started this game, Songbringer. I started with a mock-up. And that's a really, really great thing to do. So, way to go. Nice heart on the bed there. That's great. Cool, man. I'm looking forward to this game. Oh, I love this whole shot. Some cool particles coming through the window there. Rad. Oh, you're asking about Valveware. I see. Yeah. Oh, cool. So you started with Unity and C#. Great. Great decision, man. Cool. I know. Yeah. It takes forever to make sprites, right? Yeah. I know. I hope so. I'm really looking forward to them finding those kind of cool bugs. Yeah. Sweet. Good for you, Ethan. Okay, so the point. Let me, if Doc is still there, I'll show you some stuff, Doc. Let's look at some of the days that we've been through over the last few days. There's 185 where I was making the burrowing enemy. Here's the crab-like enemy. Here he is. He's super cool. I'll show you him in a second, but this crab-like enemy is great. You go and you bump a pillar, and he comes to life and moves around and stuff. Here's the jumping insect-like enemy. Here's the drolete enemy. They like run around. They run from you. They get scared, and then they fire these little projectiles at you. There's the droid bat, which flies around almost exactly like the bat from Zelda, and they move in sort of a swarm-like pattern. Here's where I was making the new mazes and stuff. The new mazes are great because they can go, instead of four different directions on each screen, you can go in 16. So there's four times the area, the paths basically. And this is the new maze generator. It works with those four different paths or 16 paths per screen. So it creates this overall maze, and then it adds in levels, and it adds in rivers and stuff. Nice. Hey, what's up? Hey, KnowingIt. So yeah, this new overworld is going to be so sweet to be able to play it. So, and this, I was inspired by Zelda and how I would actually implement Zelda with a procedural algorithm. So this is the idea I had of creating, basically, instead of four paths, there's 16 paths per screen. Yeah. Nice, McMonkey Ninja. Good for you. That's great. That's so cool to see you guys making stuff. So yeah, oh, there's so much more stuff. Oh, there's all these frogs now. There's frogs, there's flies, there's water hoppers, there's ripples on the water. What else? I forget what I was doing here. Oh, I was working on the new stuff. Oh yeah, I think you already saw this where I was teleporting and stuff. Yeah, that's pretty much it. What type of generation algorithm for making mazes? It's just a regular maze generator. I found it online. And it works by starting at a point, selecting a random direction, going across that, traversing in that direction, and then marking it as already traversed. So what happens is it goes and randomly goes until it hits a... In fact, I can just show you how it works. I've got a overworld scene which will show the game actually how it generates in real time. So here's how it works. See how it's going? It does all these paths, and see where it finds a dead end, it goes and it backtracks over what it had already traversed until it finds a place where it can start again. And what's great about this kind of maze generator is it's guaranteed to work. So if it ever gets to a point where it can't actually traverse something, it just backs up until it can, and then if it seriously can't find a way, it will retraverse stuff. See how it retraversed a few of those things there? So it's guaranteed for this maze generator to work, which is really cool. So, and then also in the overworld, it randomly places these lakes and the sea and the river and the mountain. The brown part is the mountain. The blue parts are those lakes and rivers and stuff. So this is going to be a pretty cool overworld to play once it's all done as far as the artwork goes and stuff. Nice. What language libraries? I'm using C++, and the game engine I'm using is Cocos 2EX. Yeah, I haven't checked out Pixelated. I'm sticking with Photoshop because I'm already used to it. Nice. Yeah, I've heard it's great. Yeah, it's so awesome, right? Way to go, Tappy. Yeah, totally. Okay. All right. So I'm back here in the system. I want to create a method that fires a ghost sword. So first I'm going to start with like a player projectile, which I already have one called the Palm Bolt. So let's launch a Palm Bolt. Here it is. Use item palm. So I want this to launch this projectile only if the player has full health. So if the player has e.gear.has, I don't know why this isn't working. K item ghost sword. Okay, so it creates a direction that we're gonna fire this ghost sword in. It launches the palm bolt. Let's not do this lens effect sphere. Well, I guess we can start it with that. Okay, so this should be able to launch a projectile. Whoa. Oh. It keeps on turning out. I forgot. It doesn't need to do this. Yeah, C++ is great. Yeah, Java is a great one for learning higher level of things a little bit. C#, same kind of thing. C# and Java are kind of like higher level than C++. C++ is a little lower level in the sense that you can... It's weird. I'm going to turn off that lens effect. It's kind of distracting. True. Oh, okay. What's happening is I'm getting hurt by the palm bolt. Start shot, palm bolt. Okay, let's immediately move this into the ghost sword anyway. So I'm gonna create a new type of entity for the for the ghost sword. I'm gonna base it on the palm bolt. For some reason it just keeps hitting like crazy. Ghost sword, ghost sword, ghost sword. Okay, I'll keep all this animations for now. It's an exploding shot, that's right, but I wanted to... It's not a stun. I wonder why it keeps exploding. It's so weird. All right, so I'm trying to figure out why this thing keeps exploding all the time. I guess I'll turn on debug mode. It might be that it's hitting one of these. Yeah, it's probably that. I probably should take all these enemies on the screen and make them. You know what? I should do that right away. So the world is full of these Zerub enemies. There's like a billion of them. So I'm gonna turn that off. Let's go find a regular ass area where we can try out this ghost sword without hitting enemies every single inch of the room. And they're hidden enemies too. They burrow underground, so that's what's probably making it so weird. No, it looks like I am actually, it's colliding directly instantaneously with the player. Oh, you know what? I don't want this to explode anyways. I just want it to be a ghost sword. It doesn't explode on impact. It just moves a lot like the dart. So, move static collision. Start with giving this thing a different kind of behavior. It should, since it has shot friend, do one there, move static, so it can, we can have it fly through walls, I guess. Dude, weirdness, total weirdness. Is it better to use classes or type def for games? Well, there's really no comparison between, what are you talking about? Type def is not, I don't think it's what you think it is. What are you thinking type def is? Yeah, Momir's got you there. Oh, you don't need this. Let's go to Palm Bolt. We don't need that. So anyways, back to Ghost Sword. This thing should not be exploding right away. I guess it's one of these removes. It doesn't even become an entity. Here, let me disable all these sequences here. Oh, class with everything public is a struct. Yeah, if you're going to use C++, it's better to use classes in general. But I use structs a lot these days. Yes. Oh, I think I know what's up. When we launch this ghost sword. Type, pause, dir, remove timer. Okay, so this is what's going on. It's trying to do all this helpful stuff here in this start shot function, but really it doesn't need to do this stuff because it doesn't have it. So if e.render.has, no, it's get animation. No, it's just e.profile. There, has animation key. So only do this stuff if we have that key. Right? Oh my gosh, right? Debugging? Yeah, when I came back from my vacation, I was also in the same kind of mood. I'm like, dude, I do not really want to be doing this. Yay, there we go. Now he's at least shooting. Okay, let's see if this works on enemies though. We should be able to go find an enemy. And then launch one of these things at it and hurt it. Oh yeah, cool, it worked. They definitely need to be a little bigger. So I'm gonna do, I should keep that on for a second, but let's go to Palm Bolt, Ghost Sword. We need a better graphic for this for sure, but collision, here we go. We need it to be bigger. So thinking at least 20 wide, probably like 20 tall as well. I want this thing to be able to hit things easier, hit the enemies. Sweet, good enough for now. Let's hello, Savio man. Okay, let's turn off the debug. Oh, I forgot to save it again. Let's just move the player. So draw debug, zero. Move the player. Let's put him back at the start. One screen to the right. And let's see how it looks. How am I doing on time here? We got about 15 more minutes of today's stream at least. So that's enough time to draw a sword. Really, I want this to look kind of like the Zelda 1 sword where you're at full health. Yeah, that's kind of cool. I like how quick it is. Sweet, I love this thing. This is already making the game so much more fun. So yeah, I'll get this. Okay, I'm gonna go take a quick little break. I'll come back and we'll keep working on this thing. Starting with some graphics. Yes, Savion man. Yeah, C++ man. Okay. So I'm thinking some kind of purpley sword thing. Yeah, it kinda is. What's up, Cold Fusion? Tips for beginners in C++. Yeah, I do have a tip. I would start with C instead of C++. That's my tip. Yeah. Personally, that's my best advice I would give on anyone trying to learn C++. I would start with just learning C. It's much simpler. And then once you've learned C, then move to C++. Yeah, and definitely get a book, just like Valvor is suggesting. Hey, what's up, Ben? Going great, man. So going so good. I'm making this new item called the Ghost Sword. The Ghost Sword gives you this power to shoot like projectiles out of your sword. And I'm making it. I just started with the Palm Bolt, which is an existing projectile I had for Vel. So I'm gonna make a new graphic right now for it, where it actually looks like a sword. So let me get to that. Create a new PSD for it. Thinking maybe like wider than tall. Nah, I would. Yeah, 48 pixels by 48 pixels seems to be big enough to do just about anything with pixel art, so. Yeah, you're welcome, man. Yeah. And my other tip, and anybody that's just getting started, is to do what you love. I know that sounds like cheesy advice, but when you do things that you love, it won't be work. It will be fun. And learning game development and making it fun is the ultimate awesome way to go. So that's my advice. Don't do things that you don't want to do. Just don't even do them. Do the things you want to do. Focus on what excites you. It takes years to learn how to make games. So just do the things you love. And you'll eventually get to the point where you're doing what you love. And it's freaking awesome. McMonkey Ninja. Man, this is a good question. How much separation you put between the engine and the game's unique code? I don't know. I don't really focus on that at all. I don't even think about that. I don't know. I just try and code well. I know that's not a very good answer, but I don't really know how to answer that. Because, I mean, I guess I did try and separate things with Entity Foo. I made that its own thing, right? Entity Foo is kind of a bit of my own game engine thing. This is for creating components. And it is separate from the rest of the game because it's its own kind of self-contained thing. So, I don't know. I mean, yeah, I guess in general, it's best to write code that works for any game, right? That could work in your future game projects or whatever. But a lot of times, you really do have to write specific game codes. This is kind of one of those delicate balance things. You got to like balance between working on the engine part of your game and working on the game part of your game. I'd say if in general, it's better to focus on the game part of the game because if you just keep tinkering with your engine, you're never going to make a game. So, I don't know. I would focus first on making the game cool, and then later on, going back and trying to make the game engine that you've written a little bit more universal and better and better and better and, you know, better practices and stuff like that. So, yeah. Well, sorry about that, you guys. If Vivo comes back and he's really starting to be, you know, somebody that we don't want to hear, just tell me and we can ban him or whatever, because he is kind of asking some crazy questions that are kind of driving us crazy, so we can all be friends in hell, no problem. All right, let's draw this sword. So this thing's going to float off the ground about that high. Well, they might be kind of crazy questions, but it does certainly ignite the conversation. That's for sure. All right, sprites. Common. This is the Ghost Sword East. Thinking these sort of flames and stuff will come off at a little bit of a different angle. Oh. What happened there? So get some flames. I want them to kind of flame off this other way. What's the opacity here? Opacity 50. All right, so. The Anderson Project. Oh no. Dude, don't tell me we have another troll. I'm sucking on a chicken boner right now? That's great, man. So how does it taste? Chicken boner. Bagog. Savion, yeah. Coco's 2DX. I know you asked that a second ago, and I answered a second ago, and I think the other people were answering too, but let me show you what I'm using here. This library is called Coco's 2DX. It's a cross-platform, open-source game engine, and it's pretty rad. But it's also kind of an advanced thing. Yeah, I wouldn't recommend Coco's 2DX for a beginner. I would recommend something more like Unity for a beginner or Game Maker. Okay, I'm gonna get this into the game really quick now so we can see about what it's looking like before I spend too much more time on it, making it awesome or whatever. But I'm gonna animate this. I just wanna see, first of all, what it looks like approximately. So let's get this exported. Ghost Sword East. Zero. There's a lot of property lists these days. Look at all these. It's like these are all entities. Okay, we want launch, run. I think it's just run. See if that makes it a ghost sword now. I wonder which one it is. Is it idle? Let's just change them all. Okay, and then I'll do a really simple thing. I'll just duplicate all those frames so we don't have to worry about the game crashing because it's not finding them. Gah-ho sword. See if that worked. Do I balance game development of the game with playing other games? That's a really great question. Really, really great question. Nope, I don't try and balance that at all. I mostly focus on game development. It's you know, probably because I'm a solo developer and I have to really, really focus to get stuff done. I pretty much focus on game development more than playing games. When I'm really in the project of making a game, I don't have that much time. I don't really have that much extra time in general. So any extra time that I do have, spare time, I'll spend with my girl. I'll spend like watching a movie or whatever. So, or like going for a walk or whatever. So it's, I don't know. Yeah, it's basically just all hands on deck developing. Yeah. It kind of, I don't know. I almost get obsessed with like game development. I get so into game development that I do it for so long each day. And I really don't have much time to play games, so... But I am... I just started playing Dark Souls, so... This morning, actually. I played, like, about a half an hour of Dark Souls. But anyways, yeah. Mostly development. Nice! Whoa, cool! Thanks, Savion, man. Yep, I make my own sprites. I also make my own music. So I do it all of the game development. Yeah, it'll get better. I think it needs to look a little more transparent there. Yeah, totally. And then, yeah, it's all fun. It's all fun, especially if you're in the zone. But when it comes to making games, it's, I think for me at least, it's a lot easier to be in that zone because this is what I love to do. This is, I freaking love making video games. So that's why it's really easy to get in the flow, get in the zone, and I forget how much time I actually spend making games. Okay, so I want to do a layer via cut and just make this a little more transparent. Let's try that about 50%. Yeah, totally. What's up, Malanafi? I'm making a game called Songbringer. It's a Zelda-like game. It's procedurally generated. It's coming out in about 5 months, March or so, for Steam. What's up, Watch Me Make Games? Welcome to the stream. Yes, I've been making this game for about 8 months now. This is day 180 something, but it's actually, that's not including weekends. So because I'm exporting these frames so much, I'm actually going to change this and make all of these east to start with. So I don't have to worry about re-exporting a different one each time. So you guys that just joined the stream, I'm about at the end of my stream today, but this is the video game that I'm developing here. It's Songbringer. I'm working on a ghost sword. This is like you fire the sword, or when you swing your sword, it fires this ghosty thing. A lot like Zelda 1's what the hell was that called when you have the magic sword or whatever? Not the magic sword, but your regular sword just had a magic thing if you had full health. So that was a bit too transparent. Let's try more like 75-ish. Do I think it's almost a necessity? No, I don't. I definitely don't. There's big pros and cons either way. So the pro of procedurally generated is in your replayability, but the con of procedurally generated is it's hard to make it bespoke, like a bespoke environment. You know, it's all custom created and everything. Like the original Zelda game, all the Zelda games, they're all bespoke. It's a custom world. So there's pros and cons. And I'm trying to balance that with Songbringer. I'd really like to create a procedurally generated game that feels like it's bespoke. And that just takes more time to create a world like that. So okay, so wait, it looks so bright because it's additive. Additive lighting. Man, this thing's fun. Got him. Yeah, totally. This is gonna be a sweet weapon to have. Oh yeah, it fires horizontally going north. Oh, that's great. I'm not sure I'm sold on this being additive lighting, though. I'm going to try it without additive lighting really quick. Yeah. Good night, Azarus. See you, man. Oh, it's straight up in the profile. Additive. Zero. Okay, let's see what that looks like without additive lighting. So that's what it looked like. Huh. Oh, this is such a tough call. I like them both. What do you guys think? What looked better? This more purpley one? Or the one that you saw just a few seconds ago, which was brighter. I would love to get some feedback on this, because I like them both. I like this one, and I kind of like the other one too, but it's a big decision, because when I go and animate this here in a second, like, it'll really depend on which one. I guess it doesn't really, you know what? It doesn't really matter that much. Either way, it's going to be animated. No, did I just break it? Oh, it's fine. Ah, okay. You like the brighter one? Okay. Yeah, that's actually an item, Tappy. It's the item called the Jib Stash. So you can actually acquire this item. You can either buy it or find it in some worlds. And yeah, so that's what it is. It's the Jib Stash. So it's going to be kind of a rare item, a find, and I think it'll probably give Jib some slight boost. Like maybe Jib is a little faster, or he can scan enemies a little bit faster, or something like that, because he's slick. Yeah. It's supposed to be composed of just pure energy. So it's like some kind of technology where it feeds off of your own bio energy. So as your own bio energy is stronger, it uses that energy to create the sword. So the point is for this to, I can do that really quick actually, to make it so it only launches if you're at full health, just like the sword from Zelda. And it's a controversial thing. I'm not sure whether the final version of this game will have it working that way, because I love that in Zelda 1, and I also hated that in Zelda 1, right? The fact that you're constantly striving to be at full health, which is kind of a cool thing, right? It's kind of a use stress type thing, but it's also kind of annoying in the fact that you couldn't have this awesome flying projectile sword unless you were at full health. So I don't know where to go with that, and I'm definitely open to your guys' thoughts on that, so feel free to shout out any thoughts on that. Zelda 1, how did you like that whole flying sword? Oh, that's cool. Yeah, maybe you could get a higher chance of getting rare items. Yeah. There you go. That'd be great, right? Pretty lady NPC. And only she, you can only talk to her. That's cool. Cold Fusion, no. I haven't developed any other games that are on Steam. The only other one I've created recently is an iOS game. So, yeah, this will be my first Steam game. I'm actually really, really excited about that. What's wrong with this? E dot health. These autocompletes are not working. Oh well. E. So this should only work if you're at max HP. And this is the part where I don't know. Okay, let's go back. Yeah, I liked it too better, a little bit better when it was additive lighting too. So we'll stick with additive lighting. I like that whole thought that if it is energy, it probably is makes sense for it to be brighter. What the heck? Build succeeded, but it shows 10 errors. That's weird. Yeah, true, right? Visibility. So now if I get hurt, I shouldn't be able to use it. Yeah, and now it's gone. This is kind of cool for it to be like that for now. Can always change that later. Oh, the name of the iOS game is called Hero Bash. It's a MOBA. Yep, it's called Hero Bash. If you just Google Hero Bash, you'll find it. Hey, what's up, Thomas? Nice, right on. No, Nano, I didn't. It wasn't just me. That one I made with my buddy. So my buddy did the art, and he did the design of that game, and I did the sound, and I also did the programming. So, all right, Valveware, cool, man. Yeah, cheer them on. I'm sure they'll love that. And good night. Enjoy. Hey, that's an interesting idea, Jonah19. Make it so the range is based on his health. Now that's interesting. That takes the whole concept of. So you still have access to this whole awesome weapon, right? This projectile weapon, but it's limited based on your own bioenergy. Right on. Crazy. Thank you. That's a cool suggestion. I'm going to consider that. That's a really, really great way to balance the two extremes, right? You've got, on one hand, you've got, it sucks that you lose out this ability the second you don't have full health, right? That always kind of sucked in Zelda. And on the other hand, it's kind of cool in the sense that it makes you strive to have full health all the time. So wow, I love that. I'm gonna really think about that. Thank you, Jonah19. Very cool suggestion. Or it could activate if you were low on health. That's flipping the whole idea on its head. Interesting. Very cool. Thanks, Nano. I hope you enjoy it, man. Okay, well, regardless of how that goes, let's animate it a little bit. And actually, I'm getting close to like needing to stop the stream and get some dinner, but I'll do a few more minutes. Let me just animate this a little bit. So let's get a couple more couple another frame started for that. Let's get the timeline viewing. So I'm thinking these things are kind of like wave, right? These are like waves of energy. So it'll start there, curve. Okay. Yeah, I like this idea. I like both these ideas. Very cool suggestions, you guys. In fact, this might actually be possible to animate this only with two frames. Might actually look decent with just these two flickering back and forth. These, I think, are actually a little bit too much. Yeah, what's up, Spymort? Welcome to the stream. Sorry, I'm just about to shut it down here in a second, but yeah, it's been a good day. Thanks you guys. Awesome suggestions so far. And man, this is one of the reasons I love doing live streams. It's just, first of all, it's great to hang out with you, but second of all, it's cool to get awesome ideas from you guys, either that or just feedback on stuff too. It's all like invaluable. Invaluable. Priceless. There. So that's kind of cheesy, right? But at least it'll make it look a little more alive, to start with. So let's do a rendering, those two frames, and change. Oh, I don't even know what animation it's doing here. I think it might be idle. Just change them all. Okay, we'll see how it looks. And then I'm gonna get some dinner. Did it work? I can't even tell. Oh, it definitely needs to hover. That'll really help this animation. So if it goes up and down like a pixel, it'll really help it look like it's a flying type thing and less like a rigid thing. What's up, baby? All right, so yeah, that's what I'll be working on tonight. I'll be working on this animations to make this look super cool. I'll work on a different north animation than a south animation, this east animation. I'll make it look like it's really flaming and flying, and play around with your guys' suggestions of how to actually improve it, make it kind of like the Z Zelda 1 item, but better. So, yes. All right, Loeb, see you, man. Good night, everybody. Have a good night. Enjoy yourselves. We'll see you next time.